Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy.
Hey guys, it's Dan and Jason. You're back with the Sons of Thunder podcast. It's been a while. It is December 20th. We're a few days before Christmas. We just wanted to get out a podcast kind of about the true meaning of Christmas and kind of the opposite, what the secular Christmas with, you know, the Christmas trees, Santa Claus.
Yeah, those pagan traditions that been now associated with Christmas.
Yep, right. So, Jason, should we just start with, like, the true meaning of Christmas? Like, you know, what is Christmas and,
yeah, and
why are we celebrating it and
all well, that so obviously the true Bible believer, the true Christian, celebrates Christmas as the birth of Jesus.
Right.
And there's several Bible verses that speak of that. I guess we could probably start with the Old Testament prophecy, right?
Oh, sure, yeah, let's do that. There? Yeah, good idea.
And that's Isaiah 7:14.
Right? Yeah, we'll start with that.
There's a few in Isaiah that talk about it.
Yeah, so basically in the Old Testament, which the Jews call the Tanakh, they are awaiting their Savior that is written about in the Old Testament. And it's funny how the Jews actually don't see Jesus as the Savior after he fits all of these.
It's unbelievable.
It's unbelievable.
It makes no sense. So, like, they're waiting specifically for what's prophesied in Isaiah. And then, of course, Jesus fulfills all of that.
And they
still reject it in it.
Right, which is kind of amazing. So there are a lot of verses, but Jason and I will just go over some of the ones that we know. So here's Isaiah 7:14. Now, this is Old Testament, right?
Yep.
This is not New Testament. Jesus has not been born yet. This is hundreds and hundreds of years before the birth of Jesus. But here's one of the prophecies. Isaiah 7:14. Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Wow, pretty amazing, huh? And then when you go to Matthew, you learn that Emmanuel just means God with us.
Yep.
Which is Jesus, who is manifest in the flesh.
God manifest in the flesh. Right.
So that's one of them. Pretty amazing. Wow, that's exactly what happened. Mary was a virgin, and she had a son named Jesus. And we find out more in the New Testament that the Holy Spirit, you know, came upon Mary, and that's how she became pregnant.
Right.
One thing, because it comes up, the New Bibles, it doesn't say a virgin, it says a young woman in the newer versions.
How about that?
And that is a huge deal.
Well, it removes a miracle.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Yep, exactly.
And it doesn't make God his father.
Correct. Minimizing the deity of Christ is kind of what, you know,
in a sort of subtle way, but not subtle, right? Like, it, you would read that and you're like, oh, well, a young woman, yeah, of course the virgin is a young woman. But you don't, if you think about it real hard, that, or not even really, if you just think about it, yeah, you've eliminated the deity of Christ by saying that Joseph, they also say Joseph and his mother.
The new Bibles say, when Joseph, speaking of Joseph,
his parents, right? His mother and father and mother, right?
The new Bibles say, you know, when they're referring to Mary and Joseph as his father and mother.
Right.
Where the King James says Mary,
Joseph and his mother.
Joseph and his mother.
Right. Again, that subtle little attack on the deity of Christ, right?
Because the King James Bible is saying, hey, Joseph is not his father.
Right.
You know, he's his earthly guardian, if you will.
Yep.
When he's a child. So, yeah, I mean, it's just these subtle things everywhere. But you get these hundreds and hundreds and thousands of subtle things. It's a huge deal.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
It's just like when the Romans, before they were crucified, they're plucking his beard out.
Right? Right.
Just plucking it out, plucking it out. Some of the other verses we'll go to Isaiah. Jason, this is one that you gave me. Isaiah 9:6.
Yep.
Do you want me to read it?
Go ahead.
No, this is, again, Old Testament prophecy of Jesus. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And I'll read, I guess, the next verse.
Yep.
Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. That's clearly Jesus Christ, right?
Absolutely.
By the way, the Bible here says his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. That's capital W, capital C. That's a title given to a deity, right?
Right.
God manifest in the flesh, right?
Yep.
How about this? The Mighty God. And this child that's born is going to be called the Mighty God.
Right.
The Everlasting Father. And
the.
King,
yeah.
The. Yeah. So what you're saying is, yeah, Jesus is God manifest in the flesh. It's the Father manifest in the flesh. That goes back to 1 John 5:7, where it says, there are three that bear record, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yep.
Of course, the New Bibles take that verse out.
Of course they do.
Look it up for yourself. Look up, take your Bible and look up 1 John 5:7 and see if it says, there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. See if your Bible says that. That's the best verse on the Godhead, a.k.a. the Trinity.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And then I'll just go over one more, Jason, and we can kind of move on a little bit.
Are you going to move to the New Testament now?
Well, I'm going to go to the wise men verse.
Like, oh, sure, yeah.
Because, wise men showed up not when Jesus was born in the manger.
Yes, correct.
You can talk about that.
Just a quick thing that bugs me. A lot of things bug me about some of the, modern Christmas traditions. But you'll see, these nativity scenes and the wise men are there at night with Jesus the night he was born, along with the shepherds, right?
And they'll have three wise men.
And they'll have three wise men. That's not scriptural. They didn't show up the night he was born. They were from miles and miles away.
Mm-hmm.
They came when he was like a toddler.
Yeah,
right?
He's probably like 2 years old or whatever.
Because they had heard of the, they matched up the Old Testament prophecy with that birth, mm-hmm. right? And they wanted to see him.
Right.
But they didn't go that night. They didn't meet him the night he was born. The shepherds, different story, but yeah.
So a lot of the nativity scenes have it incorrect with the wise men there.
They also have angels with wings, but...
Yeah, right. And that's Jason and I, maybe we're nitpicking, whatever. But it's just truth,
If someone out there wants to show me a Bible verse that shows that angels have wings, then go ahead.
Right. They don't.
I'm listening.
They don't have wings, and that's another story. But yeah, so when the wise men showed up, you can ask yourself, well, why are they wise men? And why did they show up? Like, how did they know this?
Yeah.
Well, it's my belief, and I believe this pretty strongly, is the Lord in the Bible called them wise men because we know the Bible is correct 100%, right? So they are wise. So why did the Lord call them wise men? Because they knew their Bible. They read their Bible and they knew it. So the Lord, when they showed up, the Lord called them wise men. It's pretty amazing, right? So if you know your Bible and you read it and believe it, the Lord's going to look on you as a wise man.
Yep.
Or wise woman, because you're reading this and you believe it. So they only had the Old Testament back then, right? The Old
Correct.
Testament scriptures. And these were people, probably Arabs from, from the East.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
So they, there's a lot of areas, but here's one part in the Old Testament where they probably read this and were like, well, we're headed out there because this is a prophecy and we got to be there. So we'll just read one verse. Numbers 24, verse 17, it says, I shall see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not nigh. There shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel, and shall smite the corners of Moab, and shall destroy all the children of Sheth. So the wise men, and you can read all Numbers 24 if you want to get a little more context, but there shall come a star, capital S, out of Jacob. And what's Jesus? The bright and morning star. He's the root and the offspring of David. So that's
Correct.
Jesus, right? So that's why God called them wise men. They read their Old Testament. They believed the prophecies. They're like, this is the King of Israel. We're heading out there. And the Lord honored them for it.
Yep.
That'd be cool to meet them someday in heaven, the wise men.
Yeah, it would.
It would be pretty amazing.
It'd be sweet, yeah.
And there's no guarantee that there were three.
No, it doesn't say it.
It doesn't number it. And I think they go with three wise men because of the amount of gifts. And that might
old frankincense and myrrh. Yeah.
Yeah. So there might have been three, but you know, there's the guy. The Bible doesn't.
Two people can bring three gifts.
Right. Or maybe it was 10.
Or four. Or
maybe
10 or 20.
Maybe it was. Yeah. Who knows how many? But anyway. Yeah. Where do you want to head with this now? So that's.
Excuse me. Well, we could move to. So we've got the Old Testament prophecy, mm-hmm. right? And there's more to that. You can read, you know, more of those verses in Isaiah, right? Chapter
all
7,
over
chapter
the
9. It's all over the Old Testament,
right?
Which Jesus says, right? And you can search the Scripture there. They're them that testify of me,
right?
So you can feel free to read more of those verses. But moving forward, and I think most of our listeners hopefully know this story, but Luke chapter 2, verse starting at verse 1, is telling the entire story, right?
Correct. New Testament, yeah.
Should we read that?
Sure. Do you want to do it?
I can read it.
Sure, go ahead.
So, yeah, Luke 2, starting at verse 1. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were, do you want me to keep, go to maybe verse, what did you have written, 14?
I wrote to 14, but.
And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord appeared upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. That's the, well, mm-hmm. good tidings, great joy, which will be for all people. Good news, he ends up being fulfilling the gospel, right?
Yep.
For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, mm-hmm. ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
Fantastic, right?
The best ever.
Yeah, so the Old Testament also prophesies of the Gentiles, you know, getting in on this.
Yep.
But that was actually written in Luke, which is the gospel to the house of Israel, right?
Correct.
And it's talked about, I think it might be in Matthew. Sorry, I don't have it. Sorry, guys. Sometimes we just shoot from the hip and we don't have all the verses written down. But it talks about...
Or we go off on a tangent and think of another verse.
Yep. So it talked about how he would save them from their sins. And he was talking about the house of Israel, right? Of course, we know they rejected him. They crucified him. And then when he rose again in Acts, they still kind of had that chance to receive him as the Savior. And when they didn't, the Lord turned to the Gentiles.
Right.
And that's where we got in on the deal,
yep.
which is fantastic. Praise the Lord, right?
Yeah, right.
I had a thought. Oh, in the Old Testament, too, I don't have the verse. It also talked about how the Savior is going to be born in Bethlehem. And where was Jesus born, Jason?
Bethlehem.
So the one mystery to me is how the Jews, Israel, actually rejected him. He is all over the Old Testament. How did they reject the Savior, their Savior? He fulfills everything that is in the Old Testament.
Hundreds of years before
these
prophecies come out.
Yeah. They said that they'd pierce his hands and feet. Guess what? Jesus was on the cross, right? All these things. It's pretty amazing. But, I had a thought. This is funny. So the Charlie Brown Christmas.
Yeah.
This is one of those tangents. If you guys haven't watched the Charlie Brown Christmas, it is amazing that they have that thing on TV. So... I just saw it. I've watched it many times when I was a kid, but I wasn't really paying a whole lot of attention to what was being said. It was just kind of Charlie Brown, and I liked the animation as a child, right? But I just watched it again this year and watched it. And Charlie Brown's like, what is Christmas all about? And they go and they talk about Santa Claus, and people are writing what they want from Santa Claus, and he's all upset because they commercialized everything. Oh, and he goes, ugh. And they go around, he's trying to figure out, and they do this Christmas play, and they're trying to figure out what Christmas is all about. Do you know how they end it? Linus, the little kid with the blanket, reads what you read in Luke and says, the true meaning of Christmas is this. And he talks about Jesus coming and saving.
How about
everything.
That?
Unbelievable. And then,
they make that in 2018.
And then it's finally over. And then it's unbelievable how good that Charlie Brown Christmas. And they're reading out of the King James Bible too when he's saying that.
So that's a good transition into what the other thing we're going to talk about. So right. we talked about the true. That's the true meaning of Christmas, right? Is it's we're celebrating our Savior and His birth, and because that's the most, you know, Jesus coming to earth and dying for us is the most important thing in this universe, right?
Yeah.
So we celebrate it, right?
Yep.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
No, right.
It's a great, I mean, why not, right?
Right.
Why wouldn't we celebrate that?
Yep.
But what it's turned into is this, like Charlie Brown, it's imparts wisdom on us. It's become this commercialized, you know, gift giving, and not that gift giving is wrong, but mm-hmm. you know, Christmas trees and Santa Claus and reindeer and Christmas music, and not all Christmas music is wrong either, but mm-hmm. You know, just this, all this stuff that completely departs from the biblical reason to celebrate Christmas.
Right.
It doesn't even mention Jesus, right?
Yep.
And even when it does, like I mentioned before, it gets most of it wrong.
Right, yeah.
So it's just proof that, you know, we're so far gone as a society, end times, apostasy, right? Even the churches get it. I mean, so, for example, we have Santa Claus.
Yeah.
We can get into that. One thing I wanted to bring up was Christmas trees.
I actually have it right now.
So do I.
Okay, go ahead. Shoot.
So, it's interesting. So, we cut down a tree, right?
We cut down a tree. And
we bring it inside.
We bring it inside.
We decorate it.
We decorate it with gold,
yeah,
silver tinsel,
all
lights.
Tinsel lights, ornaments, all that stuff. We decorate a tree.
Yep.
It's like the most inexplicable tradition.
Like, what's
what
that?
What is this about? Right. We're celebrating the birth of our Savior by cutting down a tree and bringing it inside and decorating. I mean, Jim Gaffigan, the comedian, does like a bit about this. Like, mm-hmm. it's like, it's what? This?
Where did this?
Yeah. And we take all the lights inside and we put them outside. We take the tree from the outside, we bring it inside. We decorate that.
Yeah.
Anyway, so check out Jeremiah chapter 10. And start, I guess, at verse 3.
You might maybe start at 2.
Okay, start at 2.
Just because.
Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed at them. For the customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. And I guess you can keep going to verse 5, huh?
Yeah, read 5.
They are upright as the palm tree, but speak not. They must needs be born, because they cannot go. Be not afraid of them, for they cannot do evil. Neither also is it in them to do good.
So, what we have there, it's almost funny, right?
Someone cut down a Christmas tree in Jeremiah 10.
And they put it in their house.
And they brought it in their house and decorated it.
And they
it.
Fastened it to the ground like we do.
Yep.
We might not nail it to the floor, but we nail it to a stand or screw it into a stand that sits on the floor.
Yep.
And then we decorate it. And the heathen here, like, they worship it and stuff. But the good thing is in verse 5, it says, you know, be not afraid of them, as in the trees that are nailed to the floor, by the way, in your house, which we all have right now.
Right.
Be not afraid of them, for they cannot do evil, neither also is in them to do good. So at least with that, God's kind of like, yeah, just, you know, whatever. It's just this tree.
But it's only the heathen do it.
Yeah, the heathen. It's a pagan thing.
Right.
It's a pagan thing. And what happened, you know, this is kind of ad lib history here, but what happened is when Catholicism, it's always the Catholic Church. What they did is they married Babylonian. Remember, because Babylonian religion is like Rome, right?
Correct, yep.
So when the Catholic Church, where is it located, Jason?
Rome.
Right? What they did is they married Christianity with these Babylonian traditions, and most people may have heard that. They may, oh yeah, I heard about that. Well, that's where all this stuff comes from. Well, we can show you in the Bible some of the stuff where, you know, they have to mimic, blend it together, rip it off, just to diminish Jesus. And of course, we know that's what the Catholic Church is all about.
Correct.
Right? So yeah, there's our Christmas tree. And then maybe we should segue into, where did this Santa Claus fella come from?
Yeah, oh, St. Nick?
Oh, yeah. Where did this guy come from?
Yeah. You know more about that than I do, but I can pull up verses.
Well, okay, so we got this thing where we have this Santa Claus, right?
Yeah.
And everybody knows who Santa Claus is. He lives in the North Pole. He has reindeer. He has a sleigh.
He sees everything.
He sees everything. He knows if you're naughty or nice.
He gets to every house in one night, so yep. He's almost...
He's got traits that only the Lord has.
Yeah. He's almost got an omnipresent, you know...
He's omniscient, he's omnipresent, all this stuff. Time doesn't matter for him. He's above all of it.
Yeah.
The one difference is, though... So, he's kind of the main figure in Christmas,
north,
right?
Right? He's north, right? He's up there.
So, God lives in the north. Remember, the devil even said, I will ascend above the heights of the cloud to the sides of the north.
Yep.
And in the Bible, I wish I had the verse written down, but it says, God isn't found in the east or west or south, but north.
Yeah.
Because he lives in the north.
Right.
So heaven is actually, in the Bible, known as the north. And that's why you've got Santa Claus, who's ripping off Jesus, right, in the time that he was born, right?
Correct.
He's mimicking him, and he's ripping him off. So Santa Claus has a white beard.
Yep. Can I
go ahead.
A verse for that.
Go ahead.
So this is Revelation chapter 1 and verse 14.
Talking about Jesus.
Not when he was on earth, by the way, right?
When he returns from the north,
this is what he looks like.
Yep.
So not to be confused with his time on earth. And people do that too. People get confused and they think that it's describing what he looked like when he was on earth.
No, this is what he looks like when he comes
correct.
Back.
This is what he looks like when he comes back from the north.
Which is heaven.
His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. So white hair, right?
Yep, there's Santa Claus, white hair, coming from the north.
Right.
Right? Jason, you want to bring up Song of Solomon 2:8, verse 8?
Sure thing, just give me a second here.
Sure, there's other verses too on Santa Claus, but we want to show people, like, where did Santa Claus come from, right? Because you've got the birth of Jesus, right? So what the world wants to do, Catholic Church kind of blended this together. They need to replace Jesus. They need to mimic Jesus. They need to get something else in there. Kind of like the Indiana Jones switch, right? You take the real thing and put the bag of sand on there.
Yep.
So that's what Santa Claus is doing. So
Song of Solomon 2:8. Mm-hmm. The voice of my beloved, behold, he cometh leaping upon the mountains, skipping upon the hills.
Okay. So that's Santa Claus skipping on the mountains with his deer. There's another verse in here, but I don't have it, where he comes back as a hart and a roe, which is a deer.
Well, and a lot of
skipping on the mountains. That's the sleigh coming
right.
back, right?
When he skips on houses too.
Yeah. I mean, how about Jesus comes as a thief in the night? What does Santa Claus do?
Comes at night, breaking and entering.
Breaking and entering in every house. That's a thief.
Yeah.
Do you see the ripoff here? Do you see how Santa Claus is ripping off Jesus, trying to mimic and be him?
I got another one too. We didn't write anything down about this, but and it's from Ruckman, of course. But so Santa, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know where I'm going with this. So if Santa and is technically a feminine beginning,
yeah.
right? So San Jose, San Diego, San Francisco,
San Juan.
Those are all male, like Juan, Diego, those are all male names, right?
You're saying Saint Diego is what you're saying.
Correct, yeah, I'm saying Saint.
We have Saint Nick,
John,
by the way.
Saint John, Saint Juan.
And he's known as Saint Nick, by the way, so
right.
Continue going.
So, and then Santa, you have Santa Maria.
Santa Barbara.
Santa Fe, Santa Barbara, right?
Santa Monica,
right.
All these cities in California.
Female, feminine, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the San are male. Masculine. And then you have Santa Claus.
It's kind of that. What do we got going on these days? This whole LGBT...
Transgender.
Transgender.
Maybe Santa identifies
maybe as transgender.
As a female.
Right, it's all coming together. It sounds laughable, but this is weird. Where did Santa, why isn't it Santa Claus? Santa.
Santa Claus, yeah.
What's going on with that, right? Jason, can you bring up, maybe we did, no, Zechariah 2:6.
Yep.
Here's another thing. So, remember, Santa Claus is trying to mimic Jesus, trying to mimic the Lord, right?
Yep.
He's Father Christmas, too, right? So he's taking on kind of the role of God the Father, God the Son.
He judges, right?
Yep.
He's got a book.
Yeah.
The naughty, nice book, the Book of Life, right? Yeah, there's some parallels there.
And the Lord judges you out of the books.
Right.
The difference with Santa Claus is Jesus came and died for the sins of the world, right? And by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works.
But that makes sense that the Catholic Church brought that in, though.
Right.
The Catholic Church preaches a works-based salvation.
And what does Santa say? You got to be naughty or nice.
Yep.
You work.
Yep.
It's a subtle...
You work to get on the nice list.
It's a subtle little list to get into the Book of Life.
To get a gift, right?
Unbelievable, right?
I'm sorry, Zechariah
2:6.
Got it. Ho, ho. Come forth and flee from the land of the north, saith the Lord. For I have spread you abroad as the four winds of the heaven, saith the Lord. So, ho, ho.
What's Santa Claus?
Come forth and flee from the land of the north.
So, that the Lord coming back from the north, Jesus returning. Funny enough how the King James Bible, for whatever reason, says, ho, ho, flee from the land of the north. So,
you're not getting that in an NIV, folks.
You're not going to get that in an... Open up your Bible, see if that verse says ho, ho, or not. I don't even know what it says, but I know it doesn't. I know it only shows up in the King James Bible. So we're kind of learning where Santa Claus came from. It's a ripoff of our Lord coming back and returning. So what...
And it takes away
what this
the true meaning of Christmas.
Right?
People focus on Santa, and they don't focus on Jesus.
Right.
Who else could be responsible for something like that? The devil. That's the only explanation.
Yep. So this present evil world subtly gets into our kids thinking they got to be nice. But that's a good thing to be nice, right?
Sure it is, but all good works are good things, but a thing can't save you.
Right, a man has to save you.
That's right, you're a man.
And that's why Jesus was born.
Right.
He was born. A son was born, an actual flesh and blood, God manifest in flesh, because you needed somebody to die for you who was like you.
Right.
And Jesus did what we couldn't do.
Yeah.
Pretty amazing.
Amen.
So, yeah, that's...
And so, I guess something to... I don't know, do you have more you wanted to talk about? But one thing I wanted to, I guess, bring up is, so the parallels, or the only similarity between the way a Christian looks at Christmas and the way others do is the gift-giving factor, but it's because of the ultimate gift,
right?
So that's what we need to focus on during Christmas is, Dan, if I gave you... the greatest gift that you could possibly think of during on this earth, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not talking about something that's going to last for, you know, eternity. I'm just talking about something that you really want right now.
Yeah.
What would you say? Would you reject it?
No,
you'd take it, probably.
I'd say,
right?
Sure, give it to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, why not?
Okay. So if someone came to you with the ultimate gift, the gift of eternal life through the blood of Jesus... It's a free gift. You don't have to do anything. I'm just going to give it to you.
No strings attached?
No strings attached. Nothing else tied to it. You don't have to do anything. All you have to do is accept it. What would you say? Of course, you've already said yes.
I've already said yes.
Me too. And so praise the Lord. But for those of you out there that, you know, you don't know that, or you've never heard that before, or you haven't accepted it, do that now. Right now.
Yep, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. That's what this whole podcast is about.
Yep.
Don't think about Santa Claus. Don't think about the reindeer.
And we're not trying bells. To say and we're not trying to say that all, you know, all people that are associated with those things are heathen, like we said, or evil or anything.
Right.
I've got a Christmas tree in my house.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
My kids are probably going to sit on Santa's lap and we're going to take a picture.
Mm-hmm.
I don't love that, but it's probably going to happen.
Right.
But my kids will also, my three-year-old hears about the true meaning of Christmas every night.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yep.
And that's the difference. And that's something we've got to instill in our kids, right? Is the true meaning And so they can spread that, and they can talk about that. Mm-hmm. And that's why we wanted to do this podcast.
Yep.
For, this episode.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Amen.
Okay? So that's what Christmas is about. Jesus was born. But even more importantly, you have Easter. He rose from the dead.
Right.
He died for you. He shed his blood.
Yeah, why was he born? Right.
He was born to shed his blood, and he rose again and defeated death for us. So all you have to do is, I'm not telling anybody to go to church, okay? That's between you and God.
Yeah.
And maybe you find a good church, and church is a good thing. We're not saying it's a bad thing. But
it's a thing. It's not a man.
Right.
Man's got to save you.
Right.
You're a man.
You got to have that personal relationship with Jesus where you receive him personally as your Savior. It's the easiest thing in the world.
Yep.
You've brushed your teeth this morning, right? This is easier than brushing your teeth, okay? So that's what this is all about. We're just praying people get saved. The time is short. Jason and I feel the rapture of the Lord's return is actually probably going to be in our lifetime. Could we be wrong? Of course we could. But we're living and thinking and believing like it's in our lifetime.
So, maybe today.
Maybe today. So I guess that's all I got.
Yeah, let's wrap it up there. That was good.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's
so,
it.
If you're not saved, and that's the same way I always do. If you're not saved, get saved, like we just said. I hope everybody out there has a Merry Christmas and understands the true meaning of it.
Yeah, and yeah, if you have any questions, Jason's kind of the social media guy. Reach out to him and ask him, and then...
Yeah, if you got questions or you want us to talk about a topic, Facebook, Twitter, whatever...
We'll even meet with you. We've done it before.
Yeah, we'll meet you with you in person. We've done that before. We'll buy you breakfast.
Right.
So, if you're not saved, get saved. Merry Christmas.
Listen, when you get saved, it's not just getting something for nothing. It's getting everything for nothing. See, that's what the thing is.